please ensure that your cell phones are either turned off or on silent. O God, who by the passion of Christ your Son, our Lord, abolished the death inherited from ancient sin by every succeeding generation, grant that just as being conformed to him we have borne by the law of nature the image of the man of earth, so by the sanctification of grace we may bear the image of the man of heaven through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see, those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity. One of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who had thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers. Though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood, but the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in the fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, he shall take away the sins of many, and win the pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Spirit.
hands I command my spirit. You will redeem me, O Lord, O faithful God.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
For all my foes I am an object of reproach, a laughing stock to my neighbors, and a dread to my friends. They who see me abroad flee from me. I am forgotten like the unremembered dead. I am like a dish that is broken.
Rescue me from the clutches of my enemies and my persecutors.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your kindness. Take courage and be stout-hearted, all you who hope in the Lord.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
The passion of our Lord Jesus Christ. according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out to them and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So again he asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those who gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers and tribunes and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter, He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire they had made because it was cold. They were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. In secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you hate me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of the disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Did I see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the Praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the Praetorium in order not to be defiled, so they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him,
"If you are not a criminal, we will not hand him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute anyone."
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he had indicated the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the Praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I?" Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
So Pilate said to him,
Then you are a king.
Jesus answered,
You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate said to him,
What is truth?
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
I find no guilt in him. But you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?
They cried out again,
Not this one, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head, and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
Hail, King of the Jews!
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak, and he said to them,
Behold, the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered,
We have no law, and authority to have a law on our side, because he made himself the Son of God.
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you, and I have power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in a place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for the Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
Behold your king.
They cried out,
take him away, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
Shall I crucify your king?
The chief priests answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus and carrying the cross himself, he went to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him with two others, one on either side with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus the Nazarene, King of the Jews. Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
Do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews.
Pilate answered,
What I have written, I have written.
Then when the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, one share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be.
In order that the passage of the scripture might be fulfilled, that says, They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there, whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine, so they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it in his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the Spirit. Since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of the week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they may be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then the other one, who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus, they saw he was already dead. They did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you may also come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him who they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus. And Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths along with the spices according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Yesterday in our reflection on Holy Thursday evening, we considered what St. John Chrysostom said, that the Eucharist transforms us into fire-breathing lives. It doesn't turn us into wimps. It puts us in touch with the living God, and we're made terrible to demons. And those demons see the blood of the Lamb that was slain for us on those doorposts of our heart and soul. The demons say to themselves, "Ain't even gonna try, I'm gonna move on to the next person." That's how that Passover happens to us. The thing I love about John's gospel is that he takes a lot of imagery from the book of Genesis, but also the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Old Testament, and he's putting all of these massive hints in here on who is Jesus Christ. And when this mob is looking for Jesus, he says in the same exact thing God says to Moses in Exodus 3, "I am," and you notice once Jesus says that, they fall down. They're kind of like battered by this invisible force. They fall down flat on their faces. And in John's gospel, there's the book of signs where the Lord says, I am the good shepherd. I am the gate of the sheep. I am the true vine. I am the bread of life. So that I am saying of Jesus, it's exactly what's going on in Exodus. It's what's going on here in this gospel. Jesus, the only begotten Son of the Father, God is God. We are who is not, right? And another way to think of this is that God tells each and every one of us, I am, I love you, therefore you are. Now, how do we reverently contemplate and meditate on Christ crucified? We fix the eyes of our heart, we fix the eyes of our soul on our Lord, and we look at his humanity. All we have to do is look at the way of the cross, or all these different ways in sacred art where we contemplate the fact that Jesus dumped himself out, not in little drifts, but in bucket loads. We fix the eyes of our heart on Christ, on his cross, and we recognize that Jesus received his humanity from us. It's not some generic humanity. It's not something otherworldly. But from the womb of the Virgin Mary, Jesus, our Lord, received our condition. And that is what he nailed to his cross. And we can't forget, friends, that we each have our own cross to carry, right? And out of that cross, we can either let that turn us into bitter curmudgeons, people who are constantly whining and complaining, or that cross can make us better. It can be transformed into a fount of blessing. Now in John 19, the tail end of this gospel, when the soldiers come up to our Lord and see that he is already dead, they don't break his legs. And what do? They come and they cut the side of our Lord open. And we're told that immediately blood and water flow out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. This eyewitness is probably St. John himself. He never puts himself down by name as a sign of humility. This happened so that the word of God might be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And again, another passage says they will look upon him whom they have pierced. So just as you and I were born from the side of Adam, our first parent, when God cast that deep sleep on him, Eve was formed from his side. We are all born from the side of Jesus Christ in that water, which is the new life that God gives us. It's the sacrament of baptism. We are also reborn in that blood that was shed for us. Adam and Eve were made without sin, but they chose to sin. Christ is the new Adam. Our Lady is the new Eve. And of course, they were both made without sin and followed their call, right? Our Lord taking on himself our own sinful humanity. So that's where you and I need to be today at that cross, right? And bathing ourselves in that precious blood and in that precious water.
Life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty. us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, when Christ reveals your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout all the world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray. Also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Christ our Lord.
Amen.
to his covenant. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following wise right in sincerity of heart, they may find a way to God himself. Let us kneel.
all who toil. May the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. Dearly beloved, for a swift end to the coronavirus pandemic that afflicts our world, that our God and Father will heal the sick, strengthen those who care for them, and help us all to persevere in faith. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty and merciful God, source of all life, health, and healing, look with compassion on our world brought low by disease. Protect us in the midst of the grave challenges that assail us, and in your fatherly providence, grant recovery to the stricken, strength to those who care for them, and success to those working to eradicate this scourge, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. Dearly beloved, for vocations to the Holy Priesthood of Christ in the Archdiocese of Detroit, to continue to nourish us with the body and blood of Christ through the holy sacrifice of the Mass, and strengthen us with the grace of the sacraments of the Church. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
O God, who wills to provide shepherds for your people, pour out in your Church a spirit of piety and fortitude to raise up worthy ministers for your altars, and make them ardent yet gentle heralds of your gospel, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
the adoration of the cross, we will begin processing up one by one from the middle section of the church. For the veneration, you may either place your hand on any part of the cross, you may come up and simply bow, you can do both. We simply ask that you do not kiss the cross. Please come with me.
Thank you. Mary, Mary, Mother, Mary, Mary, Mother, Mary.
man informed by divine teaching be dared to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. Please. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world, blessed are those called to the suffering of the Lamb. Almighty everlasting God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Tenebrae, or the Office of Readings for Holy Saturday, will be prayed here at church this evening at 8 p.m. If you've never experienced this liturgy, it's a very beautiful interplay between light and darkness. Also, please remember there is no confessions tomorrow at 2:30 or 4 p.m. Mass. The vigil, which will be celebrated at 8 p.m., takes the place of that. So if you hear of anyone going to the 4 p.m. Mass, tell them don't go, because it's not going to be Mass. Well, you can come at 4 o'clock if you want. I'm just going to be no Mass. The Lord be with you. Bow down your heads. May abundant blessing, the Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.